Vince, you've opened your theaters to customers. What capacity are you operating now? And I'm wondering if you can survive.
So right now, the way, you know, the Quebec Public Health has given us authorization is 250 people maximum while respecting distanciation principles, which means in this case, two seats left to right amongst bubbles that are not of the same family. But every row can be used. So we've averaged it out to about 50% capacity per auditorium. Now, can we survive if I was at 50% capacity? Yes. But the problem is that even though we're at 50% potential ability to receive customers, the truth of the matter is we're closer to a, I would say, 25% right now. So no, technically, we're still burning money right now.
Tell me about the last couple of months during the pandemic. How bad of a hit did you take?
So we got lucky because the hit wasn't as bad as it could have been. We actually had in some of our leases, or actually in every, we own part of the properties, but some others where we lease, we had actually had a force majeure clause, which waived our need to pay rental, full rental for part of March, April, May, June. But July was really rough in the sense that, you know, we opened up the 3rd of July. We thought we were going to have Tenet. We thought Chris Nolan's Tenet. We thought we were going to have Mulan. We didn't. So we ended up doing about 10% of last year's month of July. August, we went up to about 15%. But now September, we're running at about, I would say, 30-35 after 2 weeks. So we're still burning, but you know, I mean, it's like I said, it's not as bad as other people in the industry who don't have the legal writing that we had in our leases.
You mentioned some of these blockbusters, and summer is typically when Hollywood releases these blockbusters. And of course, the Toronto International Film Festival announcing recently that it would be a reduced movie schedule and a virtual event. It seems like you are at the mercy of Hollywood, that Hollywood is dictating what is going to happen here and what will happen with your business. Does that concern you?
Well, yes and no, and I'll tell you what I mean by that. So first of all, production-wise, doesn't concern me really, because Hollywood always has what we call movies on a shelf waiting to release, right? So, for example, a movie like Top Gun was, you know, scheduled to release the 25th of December. It's been moved to July of next year for now, could always move back. But there's always enough movies in the pipeline to supply us a steady flow of movies, even though production has been shut for, let's say, 5 to 6 months. So I don't have a problem there. We managed to convince Warner Brothers, you know, for the Chris Nolan movie, that the Canada was part of North America, but it wasn't the same country as the U.S. We are considered an international country. You know, I joked with them and I said, you know, you do need a passport to come to our country, right? We're not a colony, you know, so. And so they okayed releasing the movie simultaneously with 69 other countries. So we were part of the 70 countries who released internationally. That, you know, was a big step. We also convinced Paramount to release SpongeBob in Canada, while the movie will never be released in theaters anywhere in the world. It'll be released on streaming in January in the US and in Netflix, on Netflix for the rest of the world in December. So once again, it's a first. So my concern is really what's going on with the US, in the sense that as long as you have states like New York, California, Florida that are shut down, it represents a big enough market share that the Americans will just not spend the appropriate amount of money to release the pictures. And you know, the problem with movies is there's so many channels nowadays to promote a movie that if you don't use all channels, you're going to miss somebody. Too many times I get, you know, emails telling me, how come you didn't play this movie? And I say, well, we did. Only we played it 4 months ago. Where have you been? Right? And so people are sometimes delayed on the reaction. So our concern is more there. The production side doesn't really concern me. You know, but things are looking up in the sense, you know, there's polls that came out just recently from NATO, which is our, you know, theaters association. And basically 53% of people in 2 months' time, from the 1st of July to the 1st of September. So in 2 months' time, the feeling that it's okay to go to the movies and I feel safe has gone from 20% to 52%. So that's a good sign.
The pandemic has it's redefined the cinema going experience, that whole cinematic experience, if you will. People now have bigger TVs. People have made their homes their sanctuary, so they have theater rooms. How do you, or do you think about how you can redefine that theater experience? I'm wondering if there is going to be a structural change. Does that worry you?
No, I don't think so. And I'll tell you, you know, the average people right now live in a home of about 750 to 1,250 square feet, which is very small. I mean, you know, there's a lot of people, you know, touting the advantages of working at home, the efficiency of it. I got to be honest, I'm trying to close deals with people and it's taking a lifetime because the attorneys are working from home and everything's slower than it should be. And everybody's saying, well, you know, with people working at home, it's not as efficient. So the media is saying it is and real life isn't. I think that people, like every great economic crisis, every pandemic, every war, what's going to happen is people are being confined to their home. They're not willfully confining themselves. They're doing it out of fear or out of anxiousness. I can guarantee you that when it all opens up again, they will all walk away. We can only watch a movie once or twice at home before we get sick and tired of it. And then with all the specialty channels out there, you know, I think we don't need to. So I don't really believe that people have, you know, 70-foot screens in their homes. They don't have the Dolby systems that we do in our theaters. And it's a bit the same comparison I've done in the past with restaurants. We all have kitchens at home, but we don't stop going to restaurants regardless of that. And so it's the same thing. Going to the movies is a different experience. Nobody's yet presented me a model where going straight to streaming or day and date with movie theaters makes enough money to pay for a big budget movie. So the theater going experience will continue. Will it be redefined? If anything, I get the complaint that sound is too loud, it's too crisp, it's too, so I don't think sound's gonna get any louder. Screens are as big as they're gonna get. I mean, we're pretty much going to IMAX territory. And the problem with the whole VIP concept, I just don't think the business model works there. So I don't think there's an innovation down the pipeline within the next 24 months. I think the big innovation in the next 5 years will be varied content, different content, more adapted content. You gotta remember, every 10 years, every 15 years, our key demographic changes. You know, our 15-year-old becomes a 25-year-old with different priorities. So I think we're gonna have to, like happens every cyclical period for the movie business, I think we're going to have to readapt the content to more be in line with what people want to see.
When you look at the future of Cineplex, is there an opportunity there for consolidation?
There is, but let's put it this way. They're nowhere near being on the block yet. You know, management is still solidly in place there, a management that feels that the value of that corporation is much more than what its stock value is. If there's going to be a consolidation, it cannot be a straight line consolidation where we just merge the companies. It'll have to be a bankruptcy on one end, and then we would possibly buy them or whatever, because we have competitive theaters in the same markets, and to merge to then sell off my theaters or their theaters in the competitive market wouldn't make really sense. Canada's a country, but the population in Canada is no more than the state of California. So, you know, for somebody to pay the price tag that Cineworld was about to pay for Cineplex was a hefty price, I think. And I think that the Cineplex and that will emerge out of this pandemic is not going to be the same Cineplex that was there pre-pandemic. Same thing with us. I mean, you know, I think we'll all be way more indebted. I always tell, you know, the various banks that call me as an industry expert and as an economist, what my opinion is going forward. I always tell them that the saddest thing that you're going to see on my balance sheet is that I will be, you know, $10 million more indebted with nothing to show for it. In other words, there's no, you know, when I build a new theater, that $16 million in new debt, but at least I have $16 million of assets.
Is divesting an option for you? And on the flip side, is investment an option for you? What do you think of? What's the trajectory here for Guzzo Cinemas?
We've started divesting from the movie business in complementary businesses like pizzerias and then, you know, co-packing facilities for the retail of, you know, of our restaurants and back and forth and back and forth. And in fact, on Dragon's Den, you'll notice most of the deals I do, people may not realize it, but there's always a link to one of my other businesses that I can use, right? So, for example, I always try and do a spice deal somewhere. Why? Because I need the spices to do a flavored popcorn, or I need the spices in my restaurant business, and so forth and so forth, right? So we're now launching, for example, a line of caramelized popcorn, you know, in November. We're launching frozen pizza. So we're diversified. Are we diversified enough? Not to my opinion. But does that mean taking funds away from the cinema business and moving it elsewhere? No, we don't want to put at risk the cinema business, the cash flow, whatever. You know, we've looked at buying some of the properties where we are tenants with the movie theaters. That is one of the ways of diversifying, where we're using the real estate to solidify the books. We still believe in the movie business. We still believe that the movie going experience will be first and foremost once we get back to a determined form of normality, where movies will start coming out on a regular basis and where the marketing behind those movies will be done appropriately. I think things will go back to normal. And I think, as history has shown us, I think the movie theater business will flourish probably in the next 6 to 7 years. And then we'll have another down wave and so forth and so forth.